the purpose of Section 35 of CAMA 2020 and to see whether the provisions of Section 35 of CAMA 2020 can be reconciled with the ultra-vires or doctrine, at least Section 44 of CAMA 2020. So the starting point would be to pass one or two comments on Section 35 of CAMA 2020. So we have to understand that Section 35 of CAMA 2020 is a new provision in the new CAMA. So which means that under the old Act, we never had anything like Section 35. The next point to also put out there is that Section 35 of CAMA 2020 is actually a carbon copy of Section 31 of the UKCA, that is United Kingdom Companies Act of 2006. Now, it is also pertinent that we understand the philosophy that somehow governs the innovations in CAMA 2020. One thing we have to understand is that CAMA 2020 is an attempt by the Nigerian legislature to move in line with the current global trend. And what is the current global trend when it comes to the corporate regime and dispensation? The current global trend is that corporate regime is being liberalized in the sense that many mandatory provisions are somewhat being toned out, and most of the provisions are now enabling and default. So there's some sort of defaultization of the articles of association. The philosophy is that in most regime, they just want corporations to be able to get engaged in businesses. So the regime is to create some sort of convivial environment for companies to be able to do what they want to do as long as it is lawful and is not contrary to public policy. And that is why you see that when you look at the UKCA, the United Kingdom Companies Act of 2006, you see that it has actually toned down the prominence and the importance of the memo, the pari passu, the Articles of Association. When you check Section 8 of the UKCA, you see that the provisions of the memo are not as important as those in the Articles of Association. You just have to, you don't even have to state the name of the company in your memo. You just have to state that, okay, certain individuals have subscribed to the memo. All the juicy provisions that used to be in the Memorandum of Association, they are now in the Articles of Association. And the rationale behind that is that, seeing as the Articles of Association is the working document of the company, and it is easy to amend the Articles of Association compared to the Memorandum of Association, such that whenever a company even places any restriction on itself in its Articles of Association, it will be easy for the company to amend it. So we are not saying that the regime now is to make sure that you liberalize, you understand, allow companies to be able to flourish. Stop restricting them. It aligns with this sort of market individualism ideology or theory of contract, or what you can as well call the laissez faire economy or the free market economy. So having understood this, you then begin to appreciate the philosophy behind Section 35 and other innovations in CAMA 2020. So Section 35 says that unless a company has restricted, said unless a company's articles specifically restrict the objects of the company, its objects are unrestricted. So what does this mean? It means that in your articles of association, if a company does not restrict its objects, then its objects are unrestricted. Its objects are unrestricted. So what this means is that this Section 35 sub 1 is actually what I call a default enabling provision. And why is it a default enabling provision? Yes, it is that this section allows a company to restrict its objects in its articles of association. But where the company does not do so, then automatically the company will have its objects unrestricted. Now, it is pertinent to also point out that a company may use objects or it may use businesses. But then you have to understand that, at least when we look at the overall nature of the provisions, it does not appear that the drafters of the Act attached any technical meaning to the word object, in such a way that the word object can also be substituted for the word business. And this is very important, because when a company is limited by shares, it is that company that uses businesses, yes, because a company limited by shares is there for business to maximize profit. But a company that is limited by guarantee, is not there to maximize profit. In fact, they do not kind of share dividends among the members. A company limited by guarantee is set up to achieve certain objects. Maybe you can set up a company to say, okay, what we want to do is to start seeking scholarships for Nigerian students. That may be a company limited by guarantee. So they use objects. But what we are saying is that whether it is objects that you see there, it also relates to companies that are also into businesses. Now, what does this mean? It means that if a company does not limit or restrict its what objects in its AOA, then it adds its what object to all unrestricted. This is very important when you consider the ultra vires doctrine. When one considers what the ultra vires were doctrine. And how is this important? It is important that one considers section 44 of CAMA 2020 and as well consider section what used to be section 39. What used to be section 39 of our CAMA 1990 or otherwise regarded as Sega CAMA 2004. Now this is important. It is said that both sections deal with the effect of the ultra vires rule. What does the ultra vires rule say? Or what does it mean in simple form? Simply that what? If you say that this is the nature of your business, this is why you are setting up this company, then you cannot enter into a business that is not expressly stated in your network. So you set up a business to be involved or be engaged in the sale of makeup kits. Then tomorrow we don't want to see the same company delving into a business of selling fish. That is what ultra vires is all about. Now when we consider section 39 of our CAMA 1990, you see that the wordings of section 39, they are different from the wordings of section 44. Here, section 39 says that what? That a company shall not what? Delve into any business that is not authorized by its memo. That is not what? Authorized by its memo. Now, when you look at section 44 says that you cannot enter into a business that is expressly prohibited. That is expressly prohibited. Now, this is very important. Now, this is not authorized by the memo. Now, this is expressly prohibited by the memo. So now, what it means is that under the old act, for you to act or travel, it means that the company would have to delve into a business that it has not stated in its words, in its memo. So which means that because section 27 expects a company to state what its object in its word in its memo. So if you now state that, oh, we are setting up this company so that we can be selling makeup kits, that means you have authorized what this business. And if you remember the old common law doctrine and the innovations by lawyers, you know, remember the Portman and Brown case where companies will start itemizing different objects and clauses, so to say. So which means that you can also do the same and list and list and list. Now, what the old CAMA section 19 was all about is that you see anything that you state in your memo, that is your authorized business. In such a way that if you then do anything outside it, then you are acting ultra vires. But then the question is that the same meaning or the same implication that section, the new section 44 of CAMA introduces? Of course, in my opinion, I'm saying that it is not the same implication. And I say this because when you say that you do not authorize a business, it is different from when you expressly prohibit towards the business. So what this means is that under the what? Under the new CAMA, the only time that a company can act ultra vires is when the company has expressly prohibited itself in its memo that it cannot get involved in this particular business. So it means that now, unlike before, where if you state at about four, so if you want to delve into any business aside all those things you have stated, it's ultra vires. Now, what it means is that you can state as much as you want, but the only time you act ultra vires is if you have said that, oh, our own company can never, or we are not interested in entry was or delving into the business of selling makeup kits. That means you have expressly prohibited yourself. So when you now want to delve into that business, then you will be referred to what? To your memo to say that in your memo, you have expressly prohibited yourself from delving into the business of the sale of makeup kits. And because you have done that, you then look at section 44 that says that you cannot delve into a business that you have expressly prohibited in your memo. Now, when you understand what the position of the ultra vires rule is currently, and then you understand the purpose of section 35, the question is, can it be reconciled? Can section 44 and section 35 be reconciled? And I say yes, it can. Now, look at what section 35 is saying. Section 25 has said that you can also state your object in your articles of association. But understand that if you do not restrict it, then it means that what? Automatically, your objects are unrestricted. So which means that what we are saying is that if you state that, oh, we'll delve into this business of sale of makeup kits, we're going to delve into the business of sale of shoes. As long as we not say that, oh, these are the only businesses or objects that we can achieve, then automatically it means that what you can do and do and do as far as articles of association is concerned, because you have not limited your objects clause there, then it means what it is unrestricted. Now, what about the situation where you have not limited it? It means you are going to simply say that, okay, we can only delve into these war businesses. But while you are doing either of these in articles of association, one has to pay attention to your memo, because you know that your articles of association must not go contrary to the act and the memo. Now, why is it that the legislature or the drafters decided to change not authorized by the memo to expressly prohibited by the memo? It is very clear. So that if a company has expressly prohibited itself from delving into a particular business in its memo, then that company can go in its articles of association and also restrict itself from delving into the business. But then the question is, what about a situation where a company expressly prohibits itself in the memo and then it does not restrict its object in the articles of association? So which means that in its articles of association, its objects are unrestricted, but in the memo, its objects are somewhat or expressly or prohibited. We understand that the memo will take priority to the articles of association. So it means that that kind of company probably forgot that it had expressly prohibited itself in its memo and then failed to put that restriction also in its articles of association. But in that particular circumstance where there is some sort of conflict, you know that of the memo would prevail. But this is what it also means. It means that a company that is wise and wants to restrict its objects, the best thing for the company to do is not to go to the memo and expressly prohibit itself. All you just have to do is, well, state your objects clause in your memo, but do not expressly prohibit yourself and say, oh, we cannot delve into this business. If at all, you want to make sure that, oh, you don't want this company to ever delve into, you're a pastor and you don't want the company to delve into the sale of pornographic materials. So it means as you want to join the company, the best thing for the company to do is to leave, don't state it in your memo that you have expressly prohibited yourself. Go to your articles of association, then limit it. That your object, yes, it is limited to this or extent that you cannot delve into what so business, or you cannot do this and that. The reason for this is that we understand that it is easier to amend what the articles of association than for you to amend the memo. So that if tomorrow you now find out that, oh, we actually want to delve into this business, it will be easy for the company to amend the articles of association since it only restricted it in the articles of association, not the memo. But once it has expressly prohibited itself from doing so in the memo, then automatically it will affect the articles of association because the memo would supersede that of the articles of association. Then it should also be pointed out that it is also tactical, that the choice of language here is also tactical. Because imagine a situation where they have not changed not authorized by the memo, that they didn't change it to expressly prohibited by the memo. The question is, can we reconcile this language with Section 35 of CAMA? Section 35 of CAMA is saying that your object clause in your articles of association, they are not restricted, except where you were, you restricted by yourself. But let's not say that you now have your CAMA that is saying that if you want to delve into a business not authorized by the memo, now you have not authorized that. Oh, that once you delve into a business not authorized by the memo, that you have acted ultra vires. What this means is that if it's stated at about, let's say, two objects in your memo, then if in your articles of association, your articles of association is now reading unrestricted, then the question is, how is it that CAMA is restricting what? Is restricting you by saying that, oh, you cannot delve into this business because you did not state it in your memo. And you want to rely by stating it in your article of association, say that, hey, but my article of association said that as long as I do not restrict my object in the article of association, then it remains for unrestricted. Then they will still remind you that, well, you never stated it in your memo, you never stated it, so it was not your authorized business, so to say. But by saying that expressly prohibited by the memo, it means that they are giving the company the chance, the opportunity to say, if you do not want to delve into this business, you have two windows, so to say. You can either expressly prohibit it in the words in the memo. But understand that when you are prohibiting it in the memo, it has more force. Or should I say, yes, it has more force, or should I say some sort of it does not accommodate some sort of amendment, because it's not easy to amend what is in the memo. So if you have not expressly prohibited it in your memo, good for you. Then it means that perhaps you want a situation where, even if at all you guys want to now delve into that business, then you guys must go through the rigor of amending the memorandum of association. And if you do not want to go through that way, you can go through the easy way. What is the easy way? Instead of expressly prohibiting it in the memo, go to your articles of association and then restrict it. Restrict it. Now, when you have restricted it, it will appear that it's the same thing as when you have expressly prohibited it in your memo. But it's what this means is that because you have just restricted it in your articles of association, then automatically it is easy for you to then what? To amend it. So you can just amend it compared to when you have expressly prohibited it in your memo, where it may be somewhat difficult for you to amend. Or if you are the type that you just don't like that business, then do good. Take it in your memo, key it and say, we can never delve into this particular business. Go to your articles of association. Then do what? Then also restrict it that you can never enter into the business, such that even if they amend the articles of association and say, we cannot delve into this business, then you understand that as long as it's still there in your memorandum of association, then that amendment to the article of association cannot fly until they have what? They have amended that particular provision in the memo. And you can even do it this way. You can create some sort of entrenched or clauses in your memo. How do you use this to create an entrenched clause? Yes, we don't want to enter into the business of sale of pornographic materials. We wanted to incorporate the company. We have established that. But we understand that 2 years, 3 years later, we may have some sort of change or whatever, and some individuals may be pushing that, oh, we should enter into the sale of pornographic material because that is the business that is now booming, so to say. But we want a situation whereby that will not be easy to do. So what do? We create entrenched for clauses. How do we do so? When we are stating what are object laws in the memo. Now, this has already stated that we cannot delve into any business that we have expressly prohibited in the memo. So what do? We go to our article of association, we restrict it. Because if we do not restrict it, it will remain unrestricted. So we restrict it. But when we are restricting it in the what, article of association, we also take it to what, the memorandum of association and say that, you see that particular provision in the article of association that we have restricted, we are not taking it down into what, into this memo, to also state that we are expressly prohibiting ourselves from delving into this business. And that particular provision in that article of association may not be easily amended or blah, blah. So what it means that even if tomorrow the directors decided to amend the articles of association because it's somewhat easy to amend, then automatically it means that cannot work until they come and amend that provision in the memo. And before they can do that also in the memo, it automatically means that they have to do according to what the provision says in the memo. If not, any alteration to that article of association that, oh, okay, we once restricted our object, now we don't want to restrict it anymore, that alteration will still not fly when that particular entrenched clause is still in your memo. So, in my opinion, these are some of the implications, so to say, of how we can reconcile Section 35 and then comma 20. So, at the end of the day, if you want to restrict, but you're not sure whether tomorrow you may want to delve into that business, don't expressly prohibit it in your memo. Go to your articles of association, then restrict it. Then when you restrict it, if tomorrow you want to delve into that business, it will be easy for you to restrict. May I also point out that all this stress of, okay, you restrict it, then by the time you want to delve into the business, you now come back to now amend the articles of association to now to make sure that it's unrestricted. All of these things we wouldn't have gone through this whole stress or controversy if we had just done what is obtainable in England. Yes. See, the drafters of CAMA, they copied Section 35, like I stated. of the UKCA section 31. But when we are copying, we failed to copy some other provisions that would make this section 35 to work without, you know, issues. Now we check the UK Act. You see, under the UK Act, the position is that, see, even where a company restricts or limits itself in its articles of association, it is not yet even bound by the provisions. So which means that, yeah, it says you have restricted it. By the time the company wants to then introduce it, it does not need to go back and start amending its articles of association. It can decide and say, okay, yes, we restricted it, but we don't want to remain restricted because that is the position in England. But yeah, we do not have such provisions saying that the company is not really bound. When it has what restricted it to now say that, oh well, we can see, but we don't want to stay restricted. You have to come amend or amend it. So that is the first provision. Another thing is that when you look at the philosophy of our UK Act, and even in other countries that have done reform, for example, Sri Lanka, for example, if you look at Singapore Companies Act, if you look at that of New Zealand, if you look at that of Australia, you see that the current trend is to make sure that what all those juicy provisions, those lofty provisions that used to be in the memo, they are now in the articles of what, of association. But in Nigeria, no, that is not the case. In fact, our own position is similar to what is obtainable in England, in the sense that section 27 is still asking us to state what our objects clause, so to say, in our what, in our memo. And then you are still asking us to now restrict and not restrict in such a way that it will take what, the ingenuity of a company to be able to dance around this whole controversy and all. Here, there, they have already stated it. You do not have to state all these things that are important in your work memo. Carry all of them to your articles of association. And in some companies that have even said, you don't even need to state your object clause in such a way that when you do not state your object clause in your memo, by the time you somewhat restrict it in your articles of association, there is no issue of, oh, the article of association is easy to amend, and because you have not even stated that in the work, in the memo, they are not in the memo. And if you look at section 8 of the UKCA, you see that all the provisions of section 8, they are just provisions that are saying that, okay, to show that you have subscribed to the memo. You are not even stating the name of the company in the what, in the memo. You're not stating those important details in the memo. They are now in the articles of association. And in certain other countries like Sri Lanka and the likes, or New Zealand and all, you don't have to even state your object clause. You just have to delve into a lawful business. So if that had been the situation here, it then means that you have not even limited yourself or expressly prohibited yourself in your memo. You have only done that in your articles of association in such a way that you just only face your articles of association. And we don't even have the provision that says that, well, if you place any restriction in your articles of association, that you don't have to, you don't have you are not bound by it. We don't have it. And may I also point out to you that we still have section 371D, very important, section 371D, that says that once a company places any limitation on itself, it has to come and state it in their memo. So what this means is that when you limit or you restrict your object in your article of association in section 35, that is, you have restricted it, that restriction, you have to come and state it in your memo. Now you have also restricted yourself from delving into this world, into this business. Now the question is, when you are now amending the article of association to now say you have not restricted it, then even if you have not expressly prohibited yourself from delving into that same business, you have to deal with section 71D in the sense that it means that this form too has to go, because you are no longer restricting yourself in your articles of association. So there is no need for it to be in your memo. So far so good. These are the controversies, so to say, and should I say, a way to reconcile the irreconcilable, if I may put it. We are trying to merge Kamal together, we are trying to join it together, but it's like a union that seems not to work. These are my views and my opinions, but for proper elucidation and elaboration, you can get this book, Company Law, Study Path of Company Law, and Essays on Kamal 2020, written by Yusuf Oluwafemi Salako, my humble self, and my very good friend, partner, and colleague, Emmanuela Asti. It goes for 5,000 naira. If you want it, you can reach out to me, you can call me, you can send me a big on WhatsApp DM. And as you can see it, we try to harmonize the provisions of Kamal 2004 and Kamal 2020. So which means all I've said, yeah, they are there, and other provisions as well. Thank you.